Hello people, in this video we want to look at benign prostatic hyperplasia. Basically the prostate has undergone hyperplasia. Hyperplasia means more number of cells, right? Lot of cells. This is a benign condition, so it is nothing dangerous. It is not a neoplasm, it's not cancerous. So basically it's a benign prostatic hyperplasia. Hyperplasia means what, guys? Yes, it is the increase in number of cells, right? So basically let's understand this. Where does it happen, etc.? In the old men, right? Because prostate is found only in men, so this will undergo hyperplasia. Why, etc., we'll have to look at that. So you have seen this. This is urinary bladder, guys. This is your urinary bladder, and this is the urethra which is coming out of the bladder. Around it there is a organ that is prostate. Okay, this is the prostate that you're seeing here, like a heart shaped. Okay, so basically this is found only in men, right? And in older men, what can happen? This will undergo hyperplasia, and you can see here there's enlargement of the prostate. So it's called as BEP, benign enlargement of prostate, BPH, benign prostatic hyperplasia. So many terminologies. So let's get started. Basically we are looking at this in a treatment kind of perspective, how to treat. Okay, before that we will just cover a few small things. These are the zones in prostate. This is also called as McNeil zones. We have written that here, McNeil zones. So just look at this, guys. So what are the zones that we are interested in? This one, transitional zone or median lobe or middle lobe. Okay, so if this is urethra, okay, see, this is urethra, right around the urethra, whatever you have, that is the transition zone. So this transition zone is the one which undergoes hyperplasia. So this is where your all your BPH problem starts. Okay, so when this undergoes hyperplasia, what will happen? It will constrict the urethra. So these people will have urinary symptoms. Okay, so basically whenever you're treating a person for benign prostatic hyperplasia, what will you remove? You will try to remove this transitional zone, the median lobe or the middle lobe. Okay, it's in the middle, so you can understand that. So what is happening? The transitional zone TZ is undergoing hyperplasia, right? TZ. And whenever you do this removal, that is tissue removal for treating this condition, you will remove the tissue from it, TZ, that is transitional zone. Okay, just look at the other zones if you are interested in. Look at this, behind this transitional zone you have the posterior lobe, or you can also call this a peripheral zone. This is where the carcinoma occurs. Okay, carcinoma, that's why will not create much problem for the urethra, right? Only in later stages maybe. But this benign prostatic hyperplasia will cause urethral symptoms, right? So that you should understand. When, what are the other zones, guys? You have the central zone, then anteriorly they have shown some fibromuscular stroma, that is one more zone. Then what else? Okay, remember guys, when they do a perrectal exam, it is going from the rectum, right? So actually what you feel is the posterior part. Okay, that's why if you feel it is hard down, you will know it is carcinoma, right? Whatever you feel is actually the posterior part. Okay, now previously this prostate was divided as lobes. Okay, there are five lobes, you can say. The middle or median lobe, okay, this is what we said, transition zone kind of a thing, right? Then you have the anterior, that's fibromuscular stroma, is it? Posterior is where the carcinoma occurs, etc. Laterally you have two lobes, this one and this one. So totally five lobes. Anyways, we are not using this now, so let's move on. So here's the prostate. Here again they are showing middle lobe. This is what we are interested in, right? So this is showing you some pathology, guys. Look at this. This is how the microscopic appearance of this benign prostatic hyperplasia looks. All that papillae, etc., will be more, right? Anyways, now coming to etiopathogenesis, why does it happen? That's what you have to understand, right? First of all, why does it happen in detail? Let's understand. See, guys, this part, right, whichever we are telling around the urethra, so many times we are saying that this one, which is around the urethra, this portion is more, it is sensitive to estrogen and androgens also. However, the outside one, not so much to estrogen. So what happens as men become old, they will have, there will be increase in estrogen. It will stimulate the prostatic gland and that will produce BPH. So increase in estrogen. So this is what you have to remember. So what happens is increase in estrogen. So this is hormonal theory. So from theory to explain why this BPH happens. Okay. So there is a hormonal theory, and one more is the, which is the other theory, neoplastic theory. Okay, that has gone off down. Wait. Okay, let's make it like this. Hormonal theory and neoplastic theory. First, let's understand this hormonal theory. Understand this diagram here. There is testosterone, which they are calling as TS sometimes, testosterone. With the action of 5-alpha reductase, it will become dihydrotestosterone. Okay. I think DTH is it. Dihydrotestosterone. So, this is normal. But what happens with the age, the amount of TS will be dropping. So, the TS level drops. So, let me zoom here. Now, as age progresses, the testosterone level drops. Okay. But estrogen level will not fall that much. Okay. Testosterone level drops. So, what will happen? Estrogen will be more in comparison. So, there will be benign prostatic hyperplasia. What exactly? If you want to know more, guys, basically the hypothalamus pulsatile release of... this should be GnRH, right? But here it is LHRH, is it? So, luteinizing hormone will come from what? Anterior pituitary. So, if this guy's anterior pituitary is there here. This is posterior. Let's say anterior pituitary releasing what? Luteinizing hormone. This will make the testis release what? Testosterone. This testosterone will go to the prostate, right? Prostate will convert this testosterone into dihydrotestosterone. Okay, and this dihydrotestosterone is very, very potent. Basically, you understand, guys, testosterone comes from where? Testosterone comes from your testis and it comes from your adrenal cortex also sometimes, a little amount. So, basically, what happens is testosterone levels drop, okay, with age. That's it. That's all you have to know, okay? So, all that hypothalamus thing and all, not at all required for you. Anyways, neoplastic theory, another thing is there is proliferation of all the elements of prostate, fibromuscular, glandular, everything will have proliferation. Okay, this is also called as fibromyoadenoma. Fibro is fibrous, myo is muscular, adenoma is glandular. So, this is also called as fibromyoadenoma. They say that in women, they can have fibroadenoma, right? So, in men, they call it as fibromyoadenoma. That's it. So, did you understand, guys, all this theory? So, this diagram, you remember, testosterone is becoming dihydrotestosterone. Okay. So, what happens if this undergoes hyperplasia? So, let's look at this diagram first. So, here you have the bladder. Below the bladder, you have the prostate. Now, this prostate has undergone hyperplasia, because of which there is urine retention, etc. So, here what happens, the bladder muscle has to work with more pressure. So, the muscle will undergo hypertrophy. So, bladder muscle hypertrophy has happened. There's a diverticuli, so it's kind of deviated. And there's a stone because of all the urine stasis, isn't it? So, bladder stones are there. So, basically, what are the secondary effects of BPH? If somebody asks you what are the secondary effects of BPH, you will say these, that there will be changes to the urethra. So, urethra is where here? So, urethra, what will be the changes to the urethra? So, urethra has so many parts, okay, but anyways, the urethra will get compressed, it will get elongated, and it will get converted into a narrow longitudinal slit, okay? Then, changes to the bladder, we already told you there can be hyperplasia, hypertrophy of this detrusor, isn't it? Detrusor muscles. There can be some trabeculations, sacculations, etc. Diverticuli, do not forget, diverticuli. And there can be stone formation, okay? In this diverticuli, what will happen? There will be stasis of the urine, right? Here you can see stasis of the in the diverticuli, there can be stasis of urine, finally leading to stone formation. There can also be changes in the ureter and kidney. So, it's not just limited to your bladder and urethra. From the kidney, you're getting ureter, right? And this is the bladder and this is the urethra. Here is where is your prostate sitting. So, we were telling that because of this prostate enlargement, there can be urethral longing, compression. It will become elongated, compressed, etc. Bladder, you saw that there can be diverticular stones, etc. Right? The other thing is they're saying is it's not just this. There can be changes even in the kidney and the ureter. Okay. So, here they are showing you that there is diverticuli in the urinary bladder. So, there is a post-prostatic pouch with residual urine. Same thing. Now, look at this. Back pressure effects on the bladder. So, we are still talking about the bladder, is it? So, what will happen? There is hypertrophy of the bladder muscle, fasciculations, sacculations, diverticuli, stasis of the urine. There can be urinary infection, stone. Okay, so these are the effects of BPH. So, though it is a benign condition, Because it is right around the urethra, there will be problems, urinary problems. Okay, this is also called as some prostatism or something. Take a break, guys. What are we looking at today? Prostate hypertrophy. Very good. So we have finished what and all. We just now finished some secondary effects of BPH, right? Benign prostate hyperplasia. We have finished the secondary effects. Okay, now let us move on. Let's move on. See, look at this diagram here. This is nodular hyperplasia of prostate. So it is showing you how there are infolding of the glands, papillary infolding of the glands. See how much it has infolded, right? The gland. Otherwise, the gland will be how? So this is normal prostate. Look at this. This is hyperplasia of prostate. Basically, in hyperplasia of prostate, you're able to see that the glands are having so much infolding, right? And even your fibromuscular stroma, everything has become more. And this epithelium also, there will be two levels now. Basal myoepithelium, luminal epithelium, so much of epithelium. And the middle of this gland, you have something like corpora amylacea. Is it secreting a lot of things? So let us look at the clinical features of benign prostate hypertrophy. Some people are also using this term prostatism, like it is some religion or something. Okay. So let us look at this, guys. These people will have frequency of urine, urgency of urine, hesitancy. Hesitancy means what? The patient hesitates to pass urine. Okay. He wants to pass. That is the, he has urgency, but he hesitates to pass because it's ineffective. Whenever he passes urine, what is happening? The urethra is so constricted, right? You can imagine here, the urethra is so constricted because of this prostate around it, which is hypertrophied. So the whatever he tries to do, the urine will still be in the bladder, right? So it is hesitant. What is the use of even trying to push it out? It will not go out, kind of a thing. Okay. Urinary frequency. Frequency is what? It is more. Is it? Okay. Frequency means it is more. He wants to pass urine more. What is urgency? Basically, the urine can trickle down because of this internal sphincter will be getting stretched. Okay. And this urine will trickle down. He will feel like, you know, an urgent desire to pass urine. But there is hesitancy. Even though I want to pass urine, I go there, you cannot pass, kind of a thing. Okay. There will be acute retention of urine or chronic retention of urine. Okay. Then let us look at this. Hematuria basically is a complication. It's a very rare thing. Anyways, we'll put it here. And then coming to what are the clinical features? Frequency, urgency, hesitancy, acute retention of urine, chronic retention of urine. You already saw that. Now look at these lower urinary tract symptoms. He will have hesitancy. We already told you this. Poor flow, not improving by straining. Even though he strains, the urine won't come out. Dribbling, that is the trickling of the urine. Even after micturition, drop by drop, urine is coming out. That internal sphincter is not proper, right? Then, intermittent stream stops and starts. So, it will come intermittent stream. Okay, this serum. Intermittent stream. It will stop, it will come, then it will stop, then again it will come, kind of thing. Poor bladder emptying, that kind of residual retention of urine, okay? Then, episodes of near retention. So, it hasn't come out fully, kind of a feeling, right? Retention. Symptoms of storage. Storage means what will happen because the urine is there. He'll feel like going all the time, right? Frequency will be there. Nocturia, that means in the night he's doing urination so many times. Urgency, like we told you, he has an urgent need to pass, but it won't go, right? Urge incontinence. He can have incontinence, nocturnal incontinence, urge incontinence. That means he cannot control the urine coming out. Comes out when and wherever, right? Kind of a thing. Incontinence. Okay. Now let us see the symptoms scaling. There is some scale for this also. Some mild, moderate, severe, some IPSS, that International Prostate Symptom Score. Okay. Some mild, moderate, severe. If you want, you look at that. Look at this photo here. So this is normal prostate. Where is the internal sphincter? Here. Right. And where's the external sphincter? Somewhere here. Right. So this internal sphincter is what is damaged. So that guy will have trickling, dribbling and all that. So basically what will happen in a BPH, you can see here the prostate has enlarged, right? It is compressing the urethra. Because it has compressed the urethra, the urine is remaining in the bladder. Okay. So this is all about the clinical features we explained. Okay. There's some scoring if you want to know. So what happens now that all this is happening? What are the complications? Think, people, what do you think are the complications of what? You forgot the topic only. Benign prostate hyperplasia. Okay. Hyperplasia. Don't write up hypertrophy or something. Okay. Where were we? Complications. Yes. Complications of what? benign prostate hyperplasia. So there can be stones. We already told you bladder stones, etc. Diverticuli, bladder, diverticuli. Renal failure can happen because of all this stones and urinary retention, hydronephrosis and all that can happen, is it? Recurrent urinary tract infection. Okay, you can remember this. Because of all that diverticulitis of the urine and all, if it is there, bacteria will nicely grow in it. Okay, this is another microscopic image showing you BPH. Now, how will you diagnose BPH, guys? Time has come. Now, your management, that is your, how will you diagnose, what clinical tests you'll do, investigations, management, treatment, all that has come. Diagnosis of BPH. Put on a glove, ask the patient to void the urine and come back. You put on a glove and do, put your finger in the rectum and you will feel for the prostate. Which part of the prostate you can directly feel? The posterior part of the prostate. If it is hard, then you will know it is carcinoma. If it is smooth and elastic, then you will know it is BPH, okay? So, smooth elastic enlargement means you know it is BPH, okay? So, basically, you can feel the lateral lobes very easily. Then, the rectal mucosa is also free. There is no carcinoma. If it is carcinoma, this rectal mucosa won't be free, right? Because it would have infiltrated into that. So, you are actually going into what? Into the rectum only, right? So, the rectal mucosa is the first thing you will feel, isn't it? Okay, some grading is there, guys. Not sure how important this is. There's 1, 2, 3, 4. 1 is 1 to 2 centimeter. 2 is greater than 2 centimeter. 3 is some 3 to 4 centimeter. 4 is some 4 centimeter. Look at it, guys. If you need to, I'm not sure if that's important. Okay, so what are the differentials for BPH? As soon as you put your finger there and you're checking, it could be a stricture urethra because of which all the urinary symptoms are there. Bladder tumor, it could be a bladder tumor, it can be a carcinoma of the prostate, this is the first thing I would want to say, right? Carcinoma of prostate, it could be a bladder tumor, there can be some neurological cause for retention of urine like diabetes, tabes is what syphilis they are talking about, is it? Disseminated sclerosis, Parkinson's disease, some neurological issues, idiopathic detrusor activity, that is some urinary bladder, some activity is happening, bladder neck stenosis, some neck stenosis, bladder neck hypertrophy. So they are blaming the bladder's neck, nothing to do with the prostate. Something around it is causing all the problems. So here's your bladder, this is the urethra, and here you draw a heart, that's your prostate. So basically they are saying some neck issues, some bladder neck stenosis, bladder neck hypertrophy, detrusor activity, something, the neurological causes, the nerve supply to this is not proper, or some issues with that like Parkinson's, diabetes, etc. There could be a carcinoma of the prostate, not benign hypertrophy, some carcinoma of the prostate. Bladder, there has a bladder tumor, stricture urethra. Urethra has a problem, stricture urethra without the prostate doing anything. Okay, this is the differential. After this, what we will do is we have to move to investigations and treatment. Okay, so let us move to this in the next video. So this much we have to do in the next video. So in this video, we just took a complete introduction to benign prostate hyperplasia. Okay, guys, that's it. Let's meet in the next video. Bye-bye.